As we transition to inoculation theory, you're probably familiar with the term and concept. It certainly has a novel and particularly relevant medical analogy. And so we might ask ourselves how the idea of inoculation in the context of communication studies is similar or analogous to that as it is used in its medical context. I'll give you just a moment to think about that. I'll identify three ways that I believe that inoculation theory is very similar to its medical analogy. The first is that, just like the body, we as arguers seek to maintain a certain homeostasis. Recall cognitive dissonance theories and one of its key assumptions. It suggests that people seek consistency between their existing attitudes and their behaviors, which means if marketers and media individuals can exploit those various disconnections or places of dissonance, they might be able to motivate customers or consumers to move that various anchor along their social judgment continuum. The second way we might think that inoculation theory is similar to its medical analogy is that inoculation, in the medical context, functions as a strategy to protect individuals from disease. If we think about what an inoculation functionally means, it's to do a vaccination, to put a little bit of the bad thing inside of you so that your body can generate antibodies, which it then uses to fight those things in ways that the body restores to be even healthier than it was in the first place. Similarly, if we think about the context of inoculation and arguments, this is when we introduce weak arguments to an audience so that they can go, hey, that sounds weird, make up their own argument in response to that, and then as a context of that, actually generate a stronger position in refutation or in opposition to that weak argument that was presented as an initial threat. So in this sense, just like the immune system in the third point here is strengthened by threat, similarly, congruent attitudes are strengthened by the recognition of a threat and then by finding and receiving more information that confirms the ability to extinguish that threat. That new information that sought out actually helps to reduce individual audience members' dissonance and otherwise alleviate the concern in the same way that perhaps an inoculation alleviates future symptoms. So this process works like a metaphorical vaccination. The receiver becomes immune to attacking messages that attempt to change their attitudes or beliefs regarding the initial threat. So let's look at two examples of inoculation theory. Both of these examples I chose because I think they also indicate some of the characteristics we described in social norming campaigns, in that they identify behaviors that are presumably acceptable and those that aren't acceptable, and then they try to inoculate individuals into choosing in the future the right decision, in this case, to otherwise avoid cigarette smoking. So you can see, the example on the left says, you're bright enough to learn 40 different football plays, and yet you're still smoking? So that is a directly tailored and targeted message that assumes intelligence, and it hopes to suggest that those individuals who choose to smoke are making a bad decision. For those individuals who see that are non-smokers, this helps inoculate them into questions of whether they should smoke in the future by then indicating to them that smoking is a dumb choice and confirming their decision that the choice to have not smoked was a good one, a smart one, in ways that should reduce their dissonance. The second example that we see on the right says, don't be a butthead, presumably suggesting that those who throw away their cigarette butts or leave them littered on the ground are using or otherwise being rude to their neighbors and rude to those people around them. This would otherwise create an acceptance of what is socially acceptable and what is considered deviant, and again, invite individuals to cast judgment in ways that either confirm their beliefs or otherwise lead them to hopefully change their behavior. In the examples we've shown for inoculation theory, you'll note that there's an important pre-treatment happening. You have to send a message that this behavior is wrong, and then hope that the audience identifies that behavior is wrong through the inference or the association, and then confirms their own behaviors not to follow that behavior, or changes their behavior if they're already engaged in that behavior. In that sense, inoculation theory suggests that if we send out a weak version of a message, individuals can actually build counter-resistance or immunity to future versions of those messages and strengthen their position. So it uses a certain threat, you're a butthead, by inference, or you're not smart, by inference, to trigger the person's desire to fight against that threat in ways that ultimately should reinforce their attitude to change their bad habits, right? Presumably they want to be smart, they want to not litter, and so by having those cognitive dissonant beliefs provoked and evoked, it seeks to shift their opinions by inoculating a certain sense of threat and encouraging them to respond accordingly. Perhaps the best example of an inoculation campaign that also uses social norming methods is the DARE campaign. Perhaps some of you aren't familiar with the DARE campaign, but the idea of the DARE campaign was to suggest that people were going to ask you to do drugs at some point in your adolescence and your transition into high school. And their main slogan was to just say no when individuals asked you to do drugs, alcohol, or cigarette smoking. They used to hand out little business cards that told people different ways you could say no. Something like 10 different ways to say no to a joint, things of that kind. That effort to make that DARE campaign was ultimately predicated on the idea that somebody would threaten you in the future. Somebody would come to you and be like, hey man, you should smoke this joint, and here's the reasons why. And because they weren't able to make as compelling an argument as this organized campaign was, the campaign's hope was that they would be able to inoculate you at a young age by giving you at least 10 ways you could say no, so when they asked you, perhaps you could only remember two or three, but it would be sufficient to otherwise be able to just say no in the moment that mattered. That's one of the most fundamental examples of an inoculation campaign that relies on a social norming campaign. You can see here in the example to our right that it similarly relies on a slogan, a social norming campaign, that sets up what is acceptable and unacceptable behavior and then makes an argument to inoculate individuals, I am the anti-drug or I am my own anti-drug, to choose to make healthier behaviors. So in the examples we've seen, inoculation theory relies on putting out a weakened version of a threat. Perhaps the threat that you're a litterer, or the threat that you're a butthead, the threat that you're not smart, or the threat that doing drugs makes you dumb. In any of those instances, that elicits a response on behalf of the sender. The goal in these marketing campaigns is that you're aware of what their dissonance is, and you're aware of the direction they will move in those anchors, and so you can sufficiently predict when you tell them they're littering or when you tell them they're not smart, they will move their anchor to fit the, but I don't want to litter and I do want to be smart, categories that you've sought to push them into. And so in this sense, you're relying on knowing what threatens your audience or what threatens your receivers. That's important to understand that there are different types of threats. There are both the implicit threats, or those things that subtly imply the security or the risk of changing behaviors and opinions, versus explicit threats, which explicitly warn about impending persuasive attacks. The example of the DARE campaign is an obvious explicit example of explicit threats because it says people are going to come to you and ask you to do this. Here's what you say. Other ones, as we saw in the examples of the no smoking ones, are more likely to rely on implicit threats, which try to suggest that that's a behavior you wouldn't also want to be in congruence with, or that's something that should cause you dissonance. In the examples of inoculation theory we've been examining, we've noticed that the threat that's elicited to the receiver causes them to then do their own research and go through a process of otherwise fortifying their attitudes and beliefs. I believe that I'm an environmentalist, but I'm also a cigarette smoker and I've been throwing my cigarettes out my car window and on the ground around my neighborhood. You're telling me that now I'm a litterer and I'm an environmentalist? Well, I guess I'll start carrying around an ashtray and be more careful. Think about the way that similarly plastic straw campaigns, or campaigns rather to ban plastic straws, have sought to create certain forms of inoculation. And so in this sense, these forms of campaigns often will use various different strategies to get them to counter-argue for you.